And Father, we do need a change now. We love you, Lord, and we want to please you. We want to be all that you have designed us to be. And so we ask you, Lord, to look into our hearts, and if you find anything that is unlike you, that is unrighteous, that is unholy, we ask you, Lord, to point it out to us, to take it away and change us. We want to be like Jesus. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord God, for our pastor. And we pray, dear God, that you will cover him, protect him, keep him safe, and bring him back safely. We thank you for his family. We thank you, God, for the family of manna, the body of Christ here. We pray, God, that that you will use us to glorify your Son, to exalt him, to lift him up. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity of your word. We pray that you will bless it. We pray, dear God, that you will teach it. We pray, God, that you will edify your body. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Good morning again, family. Praise God. Pastor David is away. I don't think he's having fun. I think he is working. Yeah, Tracy's, he is working. And so we pray God's blessing and strength for him. I love him. And not only because he's my brother, but because he loves the Lord. And it exudes from him. And he's helping me see what I can be in the Lord. And he loves us all. And so he asked me this morning, well, not this morning, but I don't know, a week or so ago, to fill in for him. Because I'm teaching at 8, and he's obviously teaching at 11, and he's in Corinthians around the 14th chapter. And I'm in Ephesians in the 4th chapter, and we happen to be sort of overlapping as it relates to the body, the unity, and spiritual gifts. And so he asked, you know, if I would step in, and can't fill his shoes, but just ask God to bless the message this morning. If you would turn to Ephesians, and for those of you who are here and are going through Ephesians with us at 8 o'clock, this will be a little bit of a review for you, and review is good. Turn to the 4th chapter. Ephesians is a book written by the Apostle Paul to the church at Ephesus. And in many of Paul's books, those of you who study Paul, you know that he has a tendency in his writings to divide his books. And, you know, the first half is usually about doctrine. The second half is about instructions on how to exercise or apply the doctrine that he has taken us through. Ephesians is no different. In chapters 1 through 3, we have doctrine, largely about what we have, what we possess in Christ. And chapters 4 through 6 are instructions. In fact, if you allow me just to walk through briefly the first three chapters, because it gives us the context. And those of you who have been going through Sunday school with Pastor David know that context for the word is very important. And so Paul begins in chapter 1 by telling the saints in Ephesus, the Christians, us in fact, that we have these wonderful blessings in Christ and in heavenly places. And the first 13 verses cover those blessings that we have in Christ. In chapter 1, 18 through 23, Paul stresses that he's praying for the Ephesians that their eyes, that the eyes of their heart would be enlightened so that they would understand the significance of God's call for them. And not only that, but the power that God has expressed toward us saints in Christ. In fact, look at verse 18 with me real quick. Chapter 1. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and I'm reading in the New American Standard, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might, which he brought about in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places. So this power that God has towards us is the same power that he used to raise Christ from the grave. That's a blessing. It's also about, in these verses, about the authority given to Christ as head of the church. And this authority is over all principalities, all authorities on earth and in heaven. Chapter 2, I like to refer to as the formerly chapter. It starts out in verses 1 and 2. It says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world. He goes on further in verse 11. Therefore, remember that formerly you, the Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by the so-called circumcision, which is performed in the flesh by human hands, remember that at one time you were separate from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel. Well, now in Christ, what he goes on to say is that we have been made a new person. So what Christ did, Paul is telling us in this chapter, is that we formerly were dead, and now we are alive in Christ. We formerly were separated from the commonwealth of God. We are now brought together. And now we are brought together with our brethren, the Jewish nation, in one new humanity, if you will, so that the Jew and the Gentile are no longer Jew and Gentile as far as Christ is concerned. We are now one in one body, both reconciled to God through Christ. There is no longer enmity between us and God the Father. Great, great, great doctrine and principle of truth. And then chapter 3. Chapter 3 is the chapter where Paul sort of takes a little bit of a detour to tell us that he was given grace to preach to the Gentiles, and that this grace was a mystery up until now. And this ability, this empowerment was given to Paul by God to preach the gospel of salvation to the Gentiles. And that this is now being revealed to the principalities and authorities through the church. So the church is the entity through which God is using or getting the message out. That is through Man of Bible, through Wayland, through Cornerstone, First Baptist of Pimlico. God is pushing the word out through the church. And who is the head of the church? Christ. Amen. And then the end of chapter 3 is a phenomenal portion of scripture. 14 through 21 essentially talks about love, the love of Christ. In fact, the love of Christ is so great, you can't get over it. You can't get under it. You can't get past it. The love of Christ surpasses the knowledge that we have. So this takes us into chapter 4, which begins the instruction that Paul wants us to now apply these principles. And he starts out in chapter 4, and he says, "I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, entreat you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing forbearance to one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." Tremendous truth. Paul's encouragement here is really an intense encouragement. He's saying, in light of everything that I've told you in chapters 1 through 3, you are now prepared to live the life that God expects for you to live. And not to do it as an individual, but to do it in unity, in love. So the question then becomes, how does the body of Christ function? How does the body of Christ function appropriately? I submit to you that Paul is telling us here in the fourth chapter, at verse 7, how the beginning of that. So he says, "But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift." What Paul is saying is that each one of us was given supernatural enablement to live for him. Not to live for him as an individual on an island, but to live for him in the context of one body, one faith, one Lord, one God. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians. Pastor David looked at this chapter, and I just want to review it with you. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Verse 4, "Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of ministries, and the same Lord. And there are varieties of effects, but the same God, who works all things in all persons. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good." So we all have gifts. Most of us have more than one. And the gifts are intended for the common good of the body to be exercised. I believe that the gifts are essential. Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1. The gifts are essential. They're not optional. It's not like you had the ability to say, "No, I don't want any gifts," because we received the gifts when we got saved. When the Holy Spirit came to live within us, he brought with him the gifts that he gave to us in order to exercise in the body of Christ. Verse 1 in chapter 14 says, pursue love, yet desire earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. What Paul has done in this verse is he's taken the fact of love being the greatest gift from chapter 13 and said, pursue love. It is important. It is a critical thing to do. At the end of the verse, he says, but especially pursue prophecy. Prophecy meaning to proclaim the gospel. And right in the middle of those two phrases, he's put, yet desire or pursue earnestly spiritual gifts. The word there, desire, is the Greek word zelos. And it has the meaning of burn with zeal, to be fervent, to be hot. So we are not to lackadaisically consider our spiritual gifts. This, in Paul's mind, and what he's trying to convey to us is that these gifts are critical to the execution, to the functioning of the body. It's in the present tense, this word, meaning it is a continuous process of pursuing, going after, understanding what these gifts are. I dare to say that some of us sitting here today may not know what your spiritual gifts are. If you don't know what your spiritual gifts are, you don't have an ability to function in the body of Christ the way God intended for you to do. This word is also in the imperative mood. Mood is how a writer tells you how he's feeling about what he's writing at the time he's writing. So if you read a poem and it sounds sad, that's the mood that the poet was in when he wrote the poem. Well, Paul is writing this verse and using that word desire in the imperative mood, meaning it's emphatic. It's a command. It's not an invitation to think about using your gifts. It is a command to use them. Christ's gifts are critical and essential. It's like getting behind the wheel of a car. If you don't start the car, it won't move. If you don't turn over the ignition, it won't take you where you want to go. Spiritual gifts in the life of a Christian are how the body functions. Go back to Ephesians. In addition to individual spiritual gifts, God also gave the body as a whole spiritual gifts. Look at verse 11. And he gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ. So not only were we individually given spiritual gifts, but corporately we were given gifts in the presence of people who would teach us, who would help us understand how to exercise our gifts for the work of service. I submit to you, everybody, every Christian, every believer has the ability, supernatural ability, to be effective for God because, one, they have the power, it's in you. Two, the pastors, teachers are showing you how to use them. There is no excuse not to be in service for God. Now, acknowledging that we have these spiritual gifts, everybody raise your hand. I have a spiritual gift. Okay, amen. I just wanted to make sure you were awake as well. Especially Brother Dorsey. Not John Dorsey, the trustee Dorsey. We have two Dorseys. So, now that we have acknowledged that we have gifts, how do these gifts work? Well, look at verse 15 in chapter 4 of Ephesians. There's a but there, and you know that the but is a contrasting conjunction. It's connecting two different things, two opposite things. Well, I'm going to focus on the second thing rather than the first right now. And it says, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in all aspects into him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by that which every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. Three things covered here that I think we need, that Paul wants us to see. First of all, it's these three things are under the banner. I like to call it intimacy of interaction. Intimacy of interaction. So what do we see? The first thing we see is that the functioning of the body happens through verbal communication. Verse 15, speaking the truth in love. So that requires us to talk to each other the truth in love. The other thing that we need to recognize here is that all of this functioning and interaction is also under the banner of love. You see, I can't speak to you, and in this case, it's supernaturally. When I go to work and I talk to the people at work, we're talking about work, that's secular or stuff about happening on earth. All right, it's temporal. It's not supernatural. What I mean by supernatural is it is stuff that is happening outside of stuff that you can see. A couple of weeks ago, I said to the 8 o'clock service folks that supernatural is beyond this world. So think of something really, really powerful like the space shuttle going up into outer space. That's a lot of power, but that's not supernatural. A jet, how many tons does a jet weigh? And it takes off, and you're sitting there just listening to your iPod and looking at a movie, and this jet is taking off, and you don't even give it a second thought. A lot of power, but that's not supernatural. See, supernatural power comes from God, first of all, and then it has the ability to affect the mind, the heart, and the soul. So your supernatural abilities that God has given you is not about affecting what you can see. It's about affecting what you can't see in the mind and heart and soul of another person in the body of Christ. Now, what you will see is the results of that interaction, that intimacy. So, if you're speaking to someone in love with supernatural power, love given from God. So you can talk to somebody in love. The world talks about love all the time. And that love is not going to benefit you. But God's supernatural love, if I speak truth to you, you will be impacted in your heart, your mind, and your soul. The next thing we see is spiritual communication, supernatural spiritual communication. What do I mean there? Look at verse 16. From whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by that which every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. If you weren't in Sunday school this morning, you missed a wonderful class. Pastor Ron Shelton just was wonderful. One of the things he shared with us is when you're looking at Scripture, you want to interpret all Scripture literally, but you can't take everything literally. There's the author, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, gives us pictures to help us understand an underlying principle and truth that he's trying to convey. And that's what you have here. That's what Pastor Ron told us this morning. What you have here is Paul giving us a picture that he wants us to understand a spiritual truth. So in verse 15, the head of the body is Christ. The body then is us. And so what we see here is spiritual communication between the head, Christ, and the rest of the body. Now, Pastor Ron said this morning, Christ is not really sort of the head sitting on top of a body, but he is spiritually the head, okay? And we are the body. Now, what Paul goes on to tell us is that the whole, and I'm reading now out of the King James so that we can see the Greek explanation of these words a little bit clearer. In verse 16, he says, from whom, being Christ, the head of the church, the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase for the body unto the edifying of itself in love. So first we have the whole body fitly joined together. This Greek word, this Greek phrase here, is something that is happening on an ongoing basis. Okay, so it doesn't end. It's happening all the time. Fitly joined is a Greek word that means all the stuff that is necessary to construct something is in place. Now, this morning, we shared with the 8 o'clock attenders an example. I'm going to use a different example here of what this means. So how many contractors do we have in the room, people who build stuff? Okay, Muriel, all right. Oh, Cheryl, I'm sorry. Okay, yes. So if you've ever seen a bricklayer, take a brick, and he's going to put it on another brick. He's going to build a brick wall. What he does is he makes sure that that brick on all sides is able to fit with the next brick perfectly. And so if you can imagine all the bricks that went into building the tallest building in the world, and that is now in the country of Dubai. I don't know how many stories it is, but it's taller than the Empire State Building. It's taller than the World Trade Center's where it is the tallest building in the world. So if you can imagine all of those bricks and concrete and steel and all of that stuff being fitted together perfectly in place is what God is talking about with us. So spiritually in the body, God has taken each one of us and fitted us together perfectly so that he can use us. There is nothing out of place. There's nothing wrong. I think I will use that example from this morning. How many of you have gone to New York or Philadelphia recently or gone north? Okay, you know that when you on 695, if you go to 95, first of all, you got to pay attention so you don't get lost. But then once you go there, they have built this new ramp that goes up in the air, 100, 200 feet up in the air. Imagine we're driving along and it's not perfect. The bridge, the ramp would fall. That's what God is talking about here. We are fitted together. Now, the word compacted has the sense of we are causing something to happen to each other. So, Sister Alzi Berry is in intimate contact with Sheila Wilson. And Sister Berry is providing something to Sheila, and Sheila is providing something to Sister Berry, and they both are benefiting from it, and it's benefiting the body. That's what this word compacted means, bringing it together, holding it together. Now, Christ, who is the head, is supplying what we need in spiritual gifts. We are using our spiritual gifts to supply to each other. And so together, all of this is working to the glory of God. The question becomes, what is the result? Well, Paul tells us what the result is. If it's working properly, each individual part causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself. So if we're using our spiritual gifts and working together, the body gets built up and grows spiritually and numerically, all in love. Can't do it without love. So, question. What would keep the body from not functioning? See, we have nothing to do with it. Everything that I just went through, everything that Paul told us, is we are not doing anything. It all comes from God. I'm wrong. We are doing something. We are interacting with each other. We are connected. We are giving out. The cells in your body are connected. And they provide information and substance to each other in order that the body is healthy and grows. What would prevent that from happening? An infection. If you get an infection, it will cause the body to operate inefficiently. You won't function properly. An infection starts with a bacterial microorganism. You can't even see it. Something like sin sometimes creeps in. And it connects to a cell. And the cell connects to the virus. And then it spreads. And the next thing you know, you got a really bad, pussy, nasty sore. Long, long time ago, I was a child. Well, not that long ago. A little while ago, I was a child. And Mom and Daddy bought us this swimming pool. It was, you know, what y'all have seen these little plastic pools that, you know, they put in the yard for kids. And we were given the instruction, stay in the pool. Don't get out. Of course, I got out. And I stepped on a rusty rake. I don't know if Daddy remembers this. But I stepped on a rusty rake. And it punctured my heel. And I didn't tell anybody, because if I told anybody, they would know I got out the pool. Sin. You see what sin does? So it's messing with me. I'm walking around, you know, can't step down on the foot. So Daddy says, what's wrong? Nothing? Nothing? So after a long, you know, bunch of hours, he says, let me see what's wrong with you. So you know what happens after that. But that's what happens. Sin will work its way in to our lives. And if sin is present in the body of Christ, it won't function properly. There's a great example of this in 2 Samuel. And you all know the story. David the king, 11th chapter, and I'm going to kind of walk you through it, if you can turn there. 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter. you're talking about sin. So David is bad. David has, and not on his own, God has enabled this brother to conquer everything around him. So at this time, you know, it's the time of war. He should be out with the other men at war. But he's feeling good about things. He said, well, you know what? I'm gonna let the other guys handle. I'm gonna stay at home. I'm gonna let the other generals handle this battle. And in verse 1 it says, but David stayed at Jerusalem. So here he is. He's feeling good about himself. You know, he walking around, I'm David. And he's got this attitude about him. And so he walks out on his veranda, and he looks out and he sees a naked woman bathing. Now, if David's heart were in the right place, he would have fled, just like Joseph. But see, David's heart and his mind were not in the right place. And that's what happens to us. If our heart and our mind is not in the right place, we are susceptible to temptation. Because all of us are tempted. That's not a sin. It's what we do with that temptation. David should have walked away and said, somebody close the blinds and I'm going to war. But no, no. What did he do? He sees the woman, finds out who she is. So maybe he didn't stop then, but once he found out who she was, he should have stopped. It was the wife of one of his generals who's out on the battlefield fighting for him. So this is what sin does to us. It begins to distort our thinking. His thinking was distorted. I'm the king. I can do this. What? Who's gonna say anything to me? So he goes ahead. He has sex with her, and she gets pregnant. So then, to make bad things worse, he is now rationalizing, which is what sin does. If you don't pull it in, if you don't give it to God, you begin to rationalize. How can I fix this? Well, instead of doing the right thing, he brings Uriah in and he says, go sleep with your wife. Now, Uriah, being a man of integrity, says, no, I can't do that. My men are out at battle. I can't do that. So David tries several times to get him to sleep with his wife so that he could cover this thing up. Uriah says, no, I'm not doing it. So then David tries to fix it. And so he writes a note to the lead general and gives it to Uriah. Uriah is taking to the general his own death sentence. Now tell me sin doesn't do something to the heart and to the mind and to the body. He takes his own death warrant and gives it to the general. The general sends him into battle, and he gets killed. The word comes back to David, and David says, sin. A year later, baby is born. A year. Do you think David was convicted? I hope, but we can't tell from the scripture. A year later, Nathan comes to him and says, God told me to come to you and tell you you sinned. He told him a story about a lamb that was growing up in a family, and that lamb was taken away from him. It was the only one. And David said, well, who did that? Nathan said, you did it. And it convicted him. So then David pens the prayer in Psalm 51. Turn to Psalm 51. Sin. Sin. Why are we talking about sin? Infection, yes. Sin is an infection in the body. The body cannot function properly with infections in our body. David prays in Psalm 51, "Be gracious to me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the greatness of thy compassion, blot out my transgressions." David knows that he can go to God. After all, he is a man after God's own heart. And he says to God, "Wash me, clean me, for I know my transgressions." We know what we've done. We know that we have sinned. "My sin is ever before me," he says. We know it. We know it. And he goes on to say, "Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight." See, even though the sin affected Uriah and Bathsheba, and in fact, it affected David's whole generation, it was against God. When we sin against God. When we hold that sin, we're holding ourselves away from God. Because as David tells us, the fellowship with God is broken. In fact, look at verses 10. I'm sorry, look at verses 5 through 9. The first thing that we need to see is that David understands in his prayer that God is concerned about the inner being. God desires truth in the innermost being in verse 6. "And in the hidden part, thou wilt make me know wisdom." It's about what goes on in the inside, in our heart, in our mind. David also understands that God is the only one that can cleanse him. He is the only one that can renew his joy. Look at verses 10 through 13. "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from thy presence, and do not take thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of thy salvation, and sustain me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners will be converted to thee." David, in this prayer, recognized that his fellowship with God was critical. Our fellowship with God is critical. Remember the figurative body? Christ is the head. We are the body. We're connected. So if we're out of fellowship, we are disconnected from our source. Christ is the one who supplies what we need in order to function in the body of Christ. If we don't have fellowship, who are we connected to? Where are you getting what you need? TV? Friends? Newspaper? Movies? Internet? Oh, if you're getting what you need from the internet, you are on the wrong track. If you don't go on the internet with the right mind and heart, you will be gone off into all kinds of stuff. Where are you getting the source? Find my place. One of the things that we have to recognize is each of us is a cell, is an individual cell, like in the body. The cells in the body work together to function properly. When they don't, the body won't function. What keeps us from functioning is sin. If we have sin in our lives, and it may be a sin that nobody else knows about, except God. And he's the only one that needs to know. Because if you have sin and he's the one that knows about it, you're out of fellowship, which means you can't have effective fellowship with other cells because you're infected. And what you do is now bring that infected stuff into the body. So someone's has to, we have to make a change. Carolyn sang beautifully, change me now. And so I ask you, who will be the first? Who will be the first to say, change me, Lord? Who will be the leader? Who in the body of Christ here at Manna will say, I've got some issues with somebody. I got some issues with Pastor Michael. Who is going to come to Pastor Michael and say, I got some issues with you? We have to do that. If we are going to be a functioning body. Now, you can be a functioning body, okay, limping on an infected foot, okay, but it's not going to be, you're not going to be fully usable. Or we could be a strong, healthy body for Christ. Who will lead the way? Brother John led the way. I admire him. Strong man. He has other gifts. He leads in giving to the community. And there are others. And if I don't call your name, forgive me, but each of us has to find that way to be a functioning cell within the body. And if there's sin, if there's discord, if there's disunity, go to somebody, go to the brother, go to the sister, go to the pastor, go to the elder, the deacons, whoever it is, and fix it. Fix it.
To lead the way, I will be the one who will stand in the gap, who will watch and pray. I will be the one who will walk with his brother in unity, who will live by faith and integrity, who will say to the Lord, here am I, send me. I will be the one. I will be the one that God is looking for. I will never be ashamed. In the name of the Lord, I stand and proclaim, yes, I will be the one. Yes, I will be the one. Like a city on a hill who will shine a light, I will be the one. Of darkness, who will hold it high? I will be the one, yeah, who will pray for revival all over the land, who will see God's forgiveness for all our sin. Who will ask for the Lord to touch with his mighty hand? I will be the one, I will be the one that he is looking for. I will never be ashamed. In the name of the Lord, I will stand and proclaim, yes, I will be the one. Yes, I will be. I will be the one who will call our nation to holy. Who will raise a standard of righteousness?
I will be the one.
Who will trust in the Lord for the rest of the days?
Who will